What do Cheetos, plumbing pipes, pharmaceuticals, and windshield wiper blades all have in common? They're all extruded, and they're all challenges for chemical engineers to find the perfect output. Next in the Solution Show with Corey, you're going to hear from Kevin McCall as we talk about how domain experts can take advantage of amazing capabilities and leverage reinforcement learning without having to learn reinforcement learning. Next in the Solution Show with Corey. Hi there, and welcome to another edition of The Solution Show with Corey. I'm here with an excellent guest showing an excellent demo for some exciting food products plus many other things. As you all know, I love food products. Kevin McCall, introduce yourself a little bit and talk us a little bit about the group you work in and what you do.
Great. Thanks, Corey. So my name is Kevin McCall. I manage a group in Microsoft Research that's currently validating a tool set we refer to as Bonsai that allows us to create AI agents that perform optimization or direct control in highly industrial environments.
Got it. Well, obviously a very cool name, Bonsai. And the way that you described it, I completely understand everything that you just said, I promise. But maybe you may not understand it. Could you go into a little bit more detail on maybe sort of a customer that and what they may want to do with your AI toolkit and the agents that execute?
Okay, sure. So our toolkit is directed to subject matter experts, people that are deeply familiar with whatever needs to be optimized or controlled. As I said, normally in highly industrialized environments where we have environments that are characterized by high complexity and often constantly changing conditions. So for example, one of our customers might want to define their optimization problem and then have an AI agent learn to perform optimal sequential decision-making behavior to do, let's say, routing or planning in a, let's say, a supply chain context. More frequently, we'll have an industrial customer define a control problem, and they'll define how they want an AI agent to make optimal sequential control, either supervisory or direct control, of, let's say, a machine or a process. Or in this case, for our subject matter today, in this case, an extruder, you know, at Pepsi.
Tell me a little bit about what Pepsi was trying to solve here and when they came and talked to you.
Yeah, so we were contacted by a chemical engineer at Pepsi, and he was very familiar with the subtleties of how Cheetos are created, because the quality of the Cheeto that actually comes out of the extruder is dependent upon ambient factors such as humidity. It also varies with some of the attributes of the input material, such as the, for example, the moisture level of the cornmeal. The chemical engineer said, we have humans that are turning the knobs on these extruders all day long to make sure that we're creating perfect Cheetos for our customers every time. Is there a way that we could create a model of that extruder and then train an AI agent to essentially autonomously control the supervisory settings for that extruder to make the perfect Cheeto every time so that we can not only increase yield on our process, but we can also increase customer satisfaction at the same time? So that was their objective when they originally contacted us.
I mean, that's awesome. Like who would have, well, I definitely would not have thought sort of how complex it is to make a Cheeto, especially given how easy it is to eat one. Tell us a little bit about how the agents that you mentioned will help in this regard.
The way we approach the problem is that we provide this toolkit directly to the subject matter experts, like I mentioned. It could be mechanical engineers, in this case, chemical engineers, could be aeronautical or aerospace engineers. And what we do is provide them an environment that allows them to describe their, in this case, control objective, and then connect that input file to a digital simulation model of the environment in question. In this case, a digital simulation model that represents the extruder. Now, then what we do is we take that model, package it up in a container, and provision it at scale in Azure so that the agent can learn through practice. It basically practices running that extruder at massive scale overnight or over a weekend. Now, what we end up then doing is the output of that process is an agent that can practice what we call that optimal decision-making policy, that behavioral policy, right, at runtime. So once we have that agent, we then package that up into a container, we deploy it wherever it needs to go in order to be accessible to that extruder. And then we present the results to either a human operator to implement those settings through an HMI, or we can wire it directly up to the extruder so it actually passes those optimal supervisory set points to the extruder directly, you know, within the plant itself.
That's so cool. And I think the key point is that it's for the subject matter expert. So you don't need to be an AI expert to be able to get to these outcomes and be able to figure these things out and then apply them to either, you know, save costs or produce a fantastic treat. I'd love you to actually show us a little bit because I feel like from a tech perspective, it'd be great to see how little of a subject matter expert is actually required to get this done.
Okay, no problem. Yeah, we can pivot over to that. It will allow us also to talk a little bit about deep reinforcement learning and, to be frank, how you really don't need to know anything about deep reinforcement learning in order to solve problems like this within our tool set. So why don't we go over to the demo and I'll show you how it's done. Okay, so Corey, what we're looking at here is the preview Bonsai service in Azure. And so clearly I can go in here, I can turn on this public preview, and then I can launch my Bonsai workspace. That's the workspace within which I, as a subject matter expert, would define my optimization or my control objective. And I can go here, if I'm now looking at the workspace itself, I can go here to create a brain and walk through and pick what my simulation model is going to be, the model against which my agent is going to learn. But let's just go ahead and take a look at an agent I've already created, and then we'll go into some of this detail. So first of all, you'll see over here on the left under simulator, I have a simulation model called Moab. Now, I've added that model into my environment, and simply by clicking create brain and saying, I want to base this brain, I want to train an AI agent against the simulation model, it auto creates most of this file we're looking at right now. So this is a very high level language we call Inkling. It's a declarative language. So what you'll notice here, Corey, is that it doesn't describe any of the how, it just describes what we want the agent to learn. Most of this is automatically generated just by importing the file from the simulation model. So all of this information regarding the state that the agent is going to consider, the control actions that we want the agent to practice performing, all of that's automatically generated. The only thing that needs to be defined by the engineer is down here. So here I, as a, for example, a mechanical engineer or process control engineer would say, what's the goal? What do I want the AI agent to learn to do? I want it to perfectly balance this ping pong ball on a platter. So I'm going to say, drive the ping pong ball to the center of the plate. And by the way, make sure you avoid falling off the plate. Now, those might sound redundant. And the reasons that we include both are because remember that what we're creating here, what we're providing is a toolkit that provides an abstraction layer over all of the details, all of the complexity of reinforcement learning. So what we're actually doing here is we're crafting what's called a reward function in the background that will give the AI agent the directional feedback it needs while it's learning to get better at the task that we want it to perform.
Whether it succeeded or failed. Yeah, and this Moab, this is a plate, right? Like this is just so people can visualize, it's a plate that can control sort of the two directions that it goes. Is that sort of the right way to think about this?
Yeah, exactly. This is actually a physical platter that has three little servo motors and can basically move in two dimensions. It can move a platter to balance a ping pong ball. So a very simple physical device that we do workshops on this. We actually mail these things around the world so people like mechanical engineers and process control engineers can practice building agents and then putting them on the platter and then validating those agents in a physical world, right?
Yep.
So anyway, back to the input file. So I, as a mechanical engineer, I would define my goals, right? And that would then be automatically translated into a reward function in the underlying platform. I'm also defining a learning curriculum. Now, what we're asking the agent to do here is pretty straightforward. At every time step, which actually is 30 hertz, 30 times a second, it's going to take, you'll notice over here on the right, it's going to consider four variables: the location of the ping pong ball on the platter and its velocity in both dimensions. Hmm. It's considering those four variables to decide what to do. But all we're asking it to do is two things: determine the pitch and the roll of the platter, right? Pretty straightforward. So now, after I have defined, this is really all the code that I would have to define as a mechanical engineer. I would have to define the goals, define the learning plan, and then I would click train. And that would take 10 to 15 minutes to train in Azure. So if I just jump over here and show you what the training graph would look like, this demonstrates progress against the goal for not only the two explicit objectives, but then what we refer to as the overall goal satisfaction. I mean, ultimately, we want it to perfectly balance the ball on the platter every time. And so the blue line in the middle demonstrates its ability to essentially practice that control behavior as an autonomous agent. And as you can see here, it took 11 minutes of training time by training against five simulation instances in Azure in this case.
Got it. So how many, so that's training then 11 minutes, five, I mean, that's doing quite a few runs for this to learn and sort of, and build that output so that then it can be actually executed in the physical world. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah. In this case, if you'll notice the graph, this took about 120,000 training iterations to be able to really essentially perfect that behavior. Clearly, you know, when we train agents to perform much, much more complex tasks in the real world, like, you know, controlling the hydraulic systems that move a, you know, the blade of a bulldozer, or, you know, fly a drone or something with Bell Flight, it's going to be more training iterations, right? Because we have to build up more experience. The agent needs to build more experience to learn from. And we would, of course, spin up a lot more than five containers in Azure to learn from. We'd probably spin up hundreds, if not thousands, of concurrent containers from which the agent would learn through practice.
Oh, excuse me. I was just enjoying some Cheetos. Let me wash it down with a nice beverage.
I can understand.
I mean, the demo was so enthralling. So look, Kevin, it's awesome. Thank you so much for coming. I mean, just to see the power of taking content experts, chemical engineers, mechanical engineers, and enabling them to use reinforcement learning without them having to read the book on reinforcement learning.
Or the book.
Yeah, you've got one. Yeah.
The book.
Or dozens right. of books. I mean, there's probably dozens and dozens of books on this topic. And to ask them to sort of learn it is really just crazy. And so you've enabled them to be able to take advantage of what's in those books without having to open a page and really take advantage of their knowledge and skills to get their outcomes. So thank you so much, Kevin. And thank you all for joining us here on this really exciting solution show with Corey. Any show that I get to eat a Cheeto during is a win for me, at least. Hopefully also for you with all this orange powder on my face. Thank you all for joining, and we'll see you next time.